And the next item of business is the consideration stage of the Children's Services Cooperation Bill. And I call Mr. Stephen Agnew to move the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I rise to oppose Clause 1 of the bill and speak to the other amendments. The original intention of the bill was to introduce a statutory duty on government. Oh, apologies, Mr. Speaker. Moved.
Members will have a copy of the marshal list of amendments detailing the order for consideration. The amendments have been grouped for debate in the provisional grouping of amendments selected list. There is a single group of amendments. The debate will be on amendments 1 to 10 and Mr. Agnew's opposition to clauses 1 to 5 stand part, which deal with a children's strategy, services and cooperation. Once the debate on the group is completed, any amendments in the group will be moved formally as we go through the bill and the question on each will be put without further debate. The question on stand part will be taken at the appropriate point in the bill. And if that is clear, we shall proceed. And we now will move into the debate. Mr. Agnew has signalled his intention to oppose the question that clause 1 stand part of the bill. With this question, it will be convenient to debate amendments 1 to 10 and oppositions to clauses 2 to 5 stand part, which relate to a children's strategy, services and cooperation. Members should note that amendments 1 and 2 are mutually exclusive with clause 1 standing part. Amendment 4 is mutually exclusive with clause 3 standing part. Amendment 5 is mutually exclusive with clause 4 standing part. Amendment 6 is mutually exclusive with clause 2 standing part. And amendments 8 to 10 are consequential to earlier amendments. And I will alert members before putting the relevant questions. And I now call Mr. Stephen Agnew to address his oppositions to clause 1 and the other amendments and clauses in the group. Mr. Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'll try again. I rise to oppose clause 1 and speak to the other amendments. The intention of the bill all along has to be to introduce a statutory duty on government departments and other agencies to cooperate in the planning, commissioning and delivery of children's services. The aim is to cut out the waste of resources that results from departments operating in silos and which ultimately leads to wasted potential of children's lives. Because whilst this is a bill very much about processes, the ultimate aim of the bill and the ambition of the bill is to improve opportunities for all children in Northern Ireland. Since the second stage debate in January, there has been a lot of work done on the bill and indeed on the face of it with the opposition to various clauses and significant amendments. In one sense, it's a bill rewritten, but the original intentions that this House debated and supported at second stage remain at the core of the bill. In that sense, the bill is unchanged. The words are different, but the intentions are largely the same. I would like to express at the outset my gratitude for the cooperation that there has been from the Office of First and Deputy First Minister, Department of Health and other departments as well, from the OFM-DFM committee, which I have engaged with on a number of occasions, to the extent I've lost count, to the children's sector, who've been there all along and very much would say this is their bill. This is a bill that the children's NGO sector and indeed the Children's Commissioner have been calling for since 2007, and whilst I stand here today presenting these proposals very much came from the sector. I'd also like to thank the Bills Office who have assisted me throughout the process and have been invaluable, have provided invaluable support to me and further to my team, who I'd also like to thank at this stage. The work that's gone on since January has ultimately been about making this bill more effective. The cooperation that has taken place has ensured that expertise has brought to the table, the conversations have happened between stakeholders to ensure that what started as, I suppose, a single private member's bill has very much been has very much become a collaborative piece of work between departments, between officials, between the sector, between myself and between the committee. And I think in that process in itself highlights the value of cooperative working and why a bill such as this is needed. I admit, Mr. Speaker, when going into the process of engaging with the department, my fear was that I would have to protect my bill from possible compromise, a possible watering down. And I can honestly say that that has not been the case. Every step of the way, officials within OFM DFM have sought to improve the bill, enhance the bill, and make the bill more effective, and indeed in their engagement with all our departments. That has, in my view, been the intention from all who've engaged. It is, I suppose, disappointing today that these amendments aren't jointly between myself and the Office of First and Deputy First Minister, and that has been due solely to the current political situation that has meant that executive sign-off could not be made on amendments which are, in many cases, cross-departmental. And that has undoubtedly made bringing forward these amendments and moving forward with this stage more difficult to navigate, more difficult to negotiate. But I am grateful that individually parties have continued to engage, even though, due to the current political situation, the Office of First and Deputy First Minister could not put their name to these amendments. So I wait to hear from the individual parties, but in the discussions that have taken place to date, that spirit of cooperation and goodwill towards this bill does appear to continue. I had to make a judgment call as to whether or not I waited until the current political situation settled down, but at times these institutions have been hanging by a thread, and the fear that this bill would fall entirely with a possible collapse of the Assembly drove me to press on. And whilst I have worked 4 years in this bill at this point, and I've sought at all times to get it right rather than quickly, I think we're at the point now where it's time to press on, and further delay could only harm the bill, I felt, and it is really at the stage where decisions have to be made, amendments have to be made, and ultimately the Assembly to make a final decision as to whether or not this legislation, this bill becomes legislation, becomes law. The amendments that are brought forward today are largely those which were shared with the OFM-DFM committee in June. I will seek to highlight where additional amendment has been made. Further work was done over the summer and during this month, but it is largely those that have been presented to the committee and have been scrutinised by the committee. Amendments 1 to 3 would replace the original Clause 1, which I've stated my intention to oppose today. And through various, one of the aspects of the original Clause 1 that ran into difficulty was the six high-level outcomes. From the outset, that I was keen that the high-level outcomes which were lifted from the 10-year strategy for children and young people were on the face of this bill. However, I received, and indeed the departments received, legal advice that whilst the language was suitable for strategy, it perhaps was too loosely defined for legislation, which is why the shift and emphasis from the outcomes to the concept of well-being, which is more clearly recognised in law, which is defined as alluded to in the amendment within the UNCRC, But within that well-being, within that definition, we are alluding to and having regard to the six high-level outcomes. One change made from the amendments shown to the committee is that the six high-level outcomes have become seven. Again, this is just simply about giving greater definition to the outcomes. The original purpose of the outcomes remain the same. The outcomes, and to give members some insight as to why they're deemed so important, since the construction, since the writing of the 10-year strategy for children and young people, which the children's sector has been heavily engaged in, the sector as a whole has based its strategy for delivery of its provision around these outcomes, and they remain at the core of the sector's work, and the sector very much believes should remain at the core of government's work in Northern Ireland. For that reason, any changes to those outcomes in the bill would be subject to a draft affirmative resolution, ensuring that consultation would have to take place in any changes, and that, as has been done with the children's strategy, as has been done with this bill to date, that the sector and government steps forward together. Amendment 2, then, is the enshrinement of the duty to cooperate. And where this has changed, again, the intention of the original bill has remained. Where the drafting has changed is the original bill had separated out the duty on government departments from the duty on other authorities and agencies which which worked with children. I think the Amendment 2, along with the definition provided in Amendment 8, allows the term children's authorities to capture departments and agencies collectively, and in terms of drafting, I think improves the bill whilst keeping the original intentions. I think the requirement of children's authorities to cooperate with each other and the executive is what underpins this bill, what underpins the purpose of the bill. And the additional requirement of the executive to promote cooperation. And I know there was concerns around the word promote. I think the duty on children's authorities is that they must cooperate, and the promote is very much around the executive putting in, I suppose, the structures in place to ensure that cooperation happens. Amendment 3 would require, and this is a new aspect of the bill that was not in the original, one which came from very much from the Office of First and Deputy First Minister, but which one I wholeheartedly support, and that's to enshrine in law the production of the Children and Young People's Strategy. I know that officials are already working on an updated strategy. I know that the last strategy had widespread support in its ambition and scope, and it was the implementation rather than the strategy itself that had previously been criticised, and it is the application that this bill seeks to address. But I welcome in this amendment the outcomes-based approach, the enshrining in law that there must be an outcomes-based strategy, and that included in the production of any such strategy is consultation with the sector, with outside stakeholders, but importantly with children, underpinning Article 12 of the UNCRC, which requires that children be included in decisions that affect their lives. Amendment 4 would replace the original Clause 3, and this is around the pooling of funds and resources to achieve the objectives of this bill. And I believe this is a key element of the bill. And I've done a lot of research into how pooled funds work in other jurisdictions. And I think and I hope and I believe that should this bill become law, that the pooling of funds and resources will become a necessary outworking, because I do believe that's where a lot of the inefficiency arises, where you have five departments potentially. I take the example of early intervention work. You have a situation where five departments were all working with the same objectives, but working separately with separate pools of resources, separate administrators, but to achieve shared objectives. I think the pooling of those resources will increase efficiency, will improve delivery for children, and will underpin that joined up working which this bill seeks to achieve. The changes to the original proposal, the original bill applied only to government department, now includes all children's authorities, and again I think that brings in I suppose more stakeholders, and again is will improve the effectiveness of the original draft of the bill. I think the new amendment also reflects the new language that of these amendments. I will skip Amendment 5 for now and come back to it, as is one that perhaps one of the most complex aspects of the bill, and one of the areas that it has been hardest to get the drafting right. But much work has gone into bringing it this far, and as I say, I'll return to it. Amendment 6 is the reporting clause. I think it's key that we not just put the legislation in place, but that we continually scrutinise its operation and review its effectiveness. The reporting would be, the executive would be required to report every 3 years and lay a report to the Assembly, and this replaces the original reporting requirement in Clause 2. I think one of the key aspects of the report, because I think there is a degree of cynicism about the reporting mechanisms at times, but I think for me one of the key aspects of the reporting requirement is not just what have you done, but what further opportunities can you identify for cooperation. So that continual challenge to cooperate more, to cooperate better, I think is key, and will mean that the reporting cannot simply be a tick box exercise, but is a continual assessment and critique of the work of departments in terms of, and indeed children's authorities, in terms of how cooperation has taken place and delivery on the outcomes is being achieved. Amendment 7 is another new clause, and it's simply to give the executive the power to issue guidance on the operation of the bill, and I think that is a sensible amendment. Amendment 8 is about the interpretation, and as I mentioned previously, it defines children's authorities, and this was, I suppose, an aspect of the bill in its original drafting that was always difficult, and again, I appreciate the department's input into this. It brings in the departments, the agencies of the departments, and the membership of the current Children and Young People Strategic Partnership, including them all under the catch-all children's authorities term. I think it tidies up the language and means that at various stages of the bill that one group can be referred to as children's authorities, and adds definition and clarity to that aspect of the bill. The other thing that needed to be defined is the term young people. Children in law is fairly straightforward, but young people must go beyond simply the age of 18, and the definition contained in Amendment 8 mirrors that which is used in the legislation which established the Children's Commissioner. That was to ensure consistency, and does therefore include vulnerable groups up to the age of 21. I know that in some aspects of work of the departments, Some of those vulnerable groups will receive support up until the age of 25. But in terms of a working definition for the bill, and without, I suppose, wanting to produce something that may actually require significant resource, when this is really about changing cooperation, I don't believe for a second, for example, that those engaged with working with young people up to 25 will say, well, we're not included by this bill. We're not going to cooperate. I think this bill is about enshrining cooperation as good practice and as standard practice within departments. So whilst the current definition isn't a catch-all, I think it is a good workable definition which mirrors other legislation and should, through review of the bill, that definition be required to be extended to other groups. I would be open to that, but I think at this stage this is an agreement that this is a definition that does has received a level of consensus and is workable within the context of the bill. Amendment 9 is the commencement, and which would be immediate upon royal consent. And Amendment 10 is the long title, which has been revised to adequately reflect the new drafting of the bill. I said I would come back to Amendment 5 because since I laid the bill before the Assembly, Clause 4 of the original draft was that which caused the most concern, and I've worked with officials in OFM, DFM, with the sector, and I know and I have engaged with the Department of Health, who I know have worked continuously with OFM, DFM on getting this amendment right. I mentioned previously the desire to press on with this bill, and I had been asked for more time to get this amendment right. As I said, Mr. Speaker, at that time this Assembly was hanging by a thread, and certainly it's not out of the woods yet in terms of political instability. And my fear was the whole bill could fall. And I think the amendment proposed today, Amendment 5, is an improvement on the original bill, on the original Clause 4. It is that which was brought forward by officials and presented to the OFM-DFM committee, and I think it takes us in the right direction. In terms of additional time, I am willing to not move this amendment today in the hope of getting an agreed amendment for further consideration stage, but that timeline is still tight. I am keen to see this bill reach its final stage within the next number of weeks, but as there is an opportunity to make further amendments to get this aspect of the bill right, I'm certainly willing to work with anyone who seeks to do that and give every opportunity for getting there, but I don't think the bill can be delayed indefinitely. I certainly don't think it can wait until such a time as we have executive meetings again, because I have no certainty or clarity as to when that might be. So I think there is a window of weeks to get that amendment right. But I think there is a danger that we allow the perfect to become the enemy of the good. I think the amendment is a good one. I think it is important, and I suppose I'll speak to the content, and really what it's about is I suppose updating the plan, bringing within this bill the requirement that already exists in the children's order to produce a plan for that commissioning and service delivery for children. It's to ensure that includes all children, as the bill does in every other aspect. The current children's order is about children in need, but I think the research, the evidence, and indeed the work of the Children Young People Strategic Partnership has moved towards a working for all children in order to capture those who are most in need, rather than seeking to identify those in need and often missing children who fall through the gaps. I think the catch-all approach is the right one. I think it is the direction of travel. And I know that in my discussions with the Department of Health, there is enthusiasm about enshrining that. I know there were concerns about, as the original draft, in couching this within the children's order. This current draft moves it out of the children's order and simply repeals aspects of the order to avoid duplication. So I've listened to the department's concerns, and those are reflected in the bill. But throughout this process, from the beginning of this process, the work of the Children Young People Strategic Partnership has been highlighted as good practice within government. And what this amendment seeks to do, and indeed I know there has been further work to enshrine the good work of the CYPSP, to put it on a statutory footing. I know there have been some areas of concern with that, but as I say, Mr. Speaker, this is clearly something that does appear to be the direction of travel. It's something that the sector, is the children's sector, is calling for. It's something that there has certainly been a willingness to take forward within the Department of Health, and I think we have a number of weeks to get that drafting right and hopefully bring forward a very good, if not perfect, amendment. But as I say, this bill must progress, and we can't let the perfect be the enemy of the good. In conclusion then, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to thank the various stakeholders, OFM-DFM, the OFM-DFM committee, the Bills Office, the children's sector, and indeed my own team, with particular reference to Ross Brown, who's worked tirelessly on this bill. The purpose of the bill is to make good practice common practice. It's to make cooperation in the planning, commission and delivery of children's services the norm. And I hope out of that can actually be a change of culture, whereby government as a whole, we hear a lot about the failure of parties to work together, but those of us who work in this place know about the difficulties in departments working together. And if we can get this right for children, I hope that this bill, along with Mr. McAllister's opposition bill, should it receive the favour of this House, and indeed the proposed amendments, the proposed reduction in the number of departments, I hope that collectively these pieces of legislation can improve governance in Northern Ireland. Because much has been said that if the first phase of the peace process was about getting stability, the second phase has to be about good governance. I believe this bill is part of that good governance. I believe other bills will come forward that will take other steps in that direction. But very much what I want to see with this is the ending of the waste that arises from duplication, the ending of silo mentality, and the creating of the structures to work together for the best interests of children in Northern Ireland. So I ask members to oppose clauses 1-5 as originally drafted, to support the amendments tabled. I reiterate that I will not move Amendment 5 today, in the hope of getting a draft that will receive favour from all sides of the House and will be receive favour from the departments and the sector alike, and that again, as with all our other aspects of this bill, that we can receive a consensus on the way forward. Thank you, Principal or Deputy Speaker.
I call the Chairperson of the Committee for the Office of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, Mr. Mike Nesbitt. Mr. Nesbitt.
I rise to speak on behalf of the Committee for the Office of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister. I begin by commending Mr. Agnew for bringing his bill before the House today for the first of its amending stages. As you know, the OFMDFM Committee has for some time now been working on its own legislation to reform the Office of the Northern Ireland Ombudsman, and therefore we have some appreciation of the time and effort which is required to get a bill to this stage. Before commenting on the amendments, I'd like at this point to briefly inform members about the committee's consideration of this bill. Having provided earlier briefings to the committee on the development of the Children's Services Cooperation Bill, Mr. Agnew attended committee on the 14th of January, following its introduction to the Assembly. On that date, the committee also heard from OFMDFM officials, who indicated that while the department was in principle supportive of the bill, it was expected that significant amendments would be required to ensure that it met its own objectives. The bill was referred to the committee following the second stage debate on the 26th of January, and the committee stage was subsequently extended to the 3rd of July of this year, following the approval of the Assembly on the 2nd of March. The committee received 27 substantive written submissions from organisations and individuals, a number of whom indicated that they would also wish to be considered to give oral evidence. To enable the committee to hear from as wide a range of stakeholders as possible, themed panels of stakeholders were invited to give oral evidence. These panels included representatives from children's groups and the voluntary sector, disability groups and occupational health practitioners, and local councils. In addition, we heard from the Health and Social Care Board and Children and Young People's Strategic Partnership, from the Children's Law Centre, and an individual with a background in children's services planning. Two further evidence sessions were held with the bill's sponsor. This allowed Mr. Agnew to respond to a number of technical issues that had been raised in respect of the bill at an early stage of our scrutiny. And at the end of the evidence gathering phase, it provided him with an opportunity to respond to all the issues that had been raised to us. OFMDFM officials briefed the committee on the department's initial views on potential amendments to the bill on the 27th of April. At this stage, I would like to acknowledge the work of departmental officials who not only cooperated as fully as possible with the committee, but also engaged with the bill's sponsor and the sector as they carried out their own deliberations on the bill. Indeed, while officials were not in a position to present the committee with a draft of final amendments before we undertook our clause-by-clause consideration, they did provide us with a revised draft of what the bill could look like, and they discussed that with the committee on the 17th of June. Although not having the final text of amendments was not ideal, the committee took account of the department's revised draft bill in its clause-by-clause consideration of the bill. Members were also mindful that the bill's sponsor had indicated that he was content with the proposed direction of travel by OFMDFM, subject to sight of the final amendments. In completing its deliberations, the committee concluded that it was not content with all but one of the clauses as drafted. And I would stress this was in no way an outright rejection of the bill. Indeed, the committee agreed it had always been broadly supportive of the principles of the bill. It is rather a reflection of the issues that have been raised and the concerns that the bill would not, in fact, achieve its own objectives. By opposing the clauses as drafted himself today, it seems apparent the bill's sponsor is, to some extent, of the same opinion. All of the committee's deliberations are available to read in its report, which was published in July. This revised draft bill is included, and those who have had a chance to look at it will note that there is much similarity between it and the amendments which have been tabled by Mr. Agnew and others for our consideration today. Mr. Deputy Speaker, before turning to the amendments before us, I would like to highlight one issue which was of concern to some stakeholders, but which is not directly in the subject of the amendments under consideration today, and that is the issue of sanctions. Several stakeholders noted that there are no provisions regarding penalties or sanctions in respect of non-cooperation or limited compliance. The fear from stakeholders was that the duties placed on statutory authorities would become a simple tick-box exercise. The committee explored this further during the final evidence session with the bill's sponsor, and he advised that while he had considered the issue of sanctions, he was unable to identify any that were appropriate. He told the committee, and I quote, "The ultimate sanction, a judicial review, is sufficient method of holding government to account." Deputy Speaker, I would highlight that the committee has not had the opportunity to collectively consider the amendments before us today. However, as I have already indicated, they broadly mirror the text of the draft bill as seen by the committee. So I turn to Amendment 1. During its evidence gathering session, the committee heard representation from stakeholders regarding the high-level specified outcomes, which reflect the outcomes detailed in the Executive's 10-year Children's and Young People's Strategy. There was a recognition that the outcomes included in the Children and Young People's Strategy were widely accepted by stakeholders who had been consulted extensively during the development of that strategy. It was therefore felt by some who responded to the committee that the high-level outcomes should be replicated exactly as they are within the strategy. Others, however, suggested that as a new Children and Young People's Strategy is due post-2016, rather than specify high-level outcomes, the legislation should simply link to high-level outcomes in the Children's Strategy currently operative. It was believed this approach would not predetermine or fetter the development of the new strategy. In responding to this issue, the bill sponsor advised the committee that he would be concerned if the bill was to link solely to the Children's Strategy, as this would not cover other relevant departmental strategies or initiatives, for example, early years within the Department of Education. In presenting their draft revised bill to committee, officials advised that they did not believe it would be appropriate to include high-level outcomes from the Children's Strategy in legislation, but to include high-level policy outcomes instead. Officials also indicated that including an enabling power for the First Minister and Deputy First Minister to amend the legislation if required would provide the appropriate mechanism for any necessary changes. The provision for OFM-DFM to amend subsection 2 by means of affirmative resolution is included in the amendment. In its deliberations, the committee agreed that it was broadly content with the department's proposal. While the committee did not have an opportunity to reach a position on the amendment before us today, I note that it is largely similar, with the addition of the enjoyment of play and leisure as one of the high-level specified outcomes, number 7, as referred to by the bill sponsor. Amendment 2, which introduces a new clause, cooperation to improve well-being, also mirrors that of the revised draft bill presented to the committee by officials. In their briefing to the committee, officials explained that this would not only require departments and other statutory bodies to cooperate, but they would also have to pay regard to and work with other bodies delivering children's services, such as non-governmental organisations. In considering the draft revised bill, members discussed with officials the use of the word promote in the new clause 1B, subsection 2. There was a suggestion that the term advance may place a stronger duty on departments to cooperate, and perhaps the member could clarify his views on promote versus advance in this session. Again, the committee had been content with the direction of travel indicated by OFM-DFM. The committee has not had the opportunity to reach its final position on the text of the amendment before us today, although I note there is no change to what was presented by the department during committee stage. Deputy Speaker, Amendment 3 introduces a new clause that requires the executive to bring forward a strategy to improve the well-being of children and young people. It sets out what should be included in the strategy and the requirements in respect of consultation, including consultation with children and young people, with parents, guardians, and representative bodies. Consultation with children is therefore embedded in the bill, and the text before us today replicates that which was included in the department's proposals. Amendment 5 is a new clause which provides for a children and young persons plan. The new clause proposes that the executive will be required to adopt a plan setting out how children's services will be planned, commissioned, and delivered to support the achievement of the strategy, and it is the same as what was proposed in the department's revised draft bill. However, in our discussions with officials, they advised that they did not believe that their proposal was sufficient at that stage to deliver what is required, and indeed a further clause may be required. In this regard, discussions were ongoing with CYPSP, the Department of Health, and the Department of Education with regard to a statutory partnership comprising members of the HSBC, Health and Social Care Trust, the Education Authority, and other relevant agencies within those two departments. This statutory partnership would be enabled to develop and to deliver the plan. In deliberations on the OFM-DFM's proposals, which relate to Amendments 3 and 5 before us today, members recognised that further amendments were actively being considered. The committee was therefore unable to reach a position and agreed that its support or otherwise would be dependent on sight of the final amendments. Amendment 4 provides an enabling power in the respective departments pooling budgets and sharing resources, and broadly reflects the text of the revised draft bill provided to us by officials. The original bill also contained an enabling power which would permit Northern Ireland departments to establish pooled budgets and share resources to achieve the high-level outcomes. Many stakeholders welcomed the provisions regarding the pooling of budgets and sharing of resources and believe it would make it easier for departments to share financial and staff resources to deliver the specified outcomes. Indeed, delivering social change, coordinated by OFM-DFM, was cited as an example of good practice in this regard. Stakeholders also stressed the importance of clear governance and accountability arrangements. The committee agreed that it was broadly content with OFM-DFM's direction of travel on this issue, subject, of course, to sight of the final wording of the proposed amendment. Deputy Speaker, a key provision of the bill, as introduced by the member, is a report on cooperation, which was to be published periodically on the progress of the departments towards achieving specified outcomes, the extent to which they had cooperated with each other, and any efficiency achieved through cooperation. Amendment 6 provides for a much more substantive report, again reflecting the draft revised bill prepared by OFM-DFM officials. The report, as provided for this amendment, will include a range of information, such as actions to be taken to achieve the outcomes in the strategy, progress made in the achievement of the outcomes, whether or not the well-being of children and young people has improved, and the cooperation that has taken place across departments and how it could be improved. It also provides for reporting to take place on a three-yearly basis. The amendment may address concerns that while the report provided for in the bill as introduced would focus on how departments have cooperated, it would not necessarily show how that cooperation has led to better outcomes for children. The principle of a cooperation report was welcomed by those who responded to the committee, although a number of those considered reporting should be at annual intervals rather than every 3 years. Against this, concern was expressed about placing an extra administrative burden on departments through additional reporting requirements, and perhaps the member could advise us the rationale for a three-year reporting cycle. The committee also noted that Mr. Agnew had also expressed a preference for the report to be conducted by an independent body, and he may also wish to provide some clarification on this issue. Amendment 7 is a new clause which grants an enabling power on OFM-DFM to issue guidance on the exercise of functions conferred by the legislation. Although guidance for departments was an area raised by some stakeholders during committee stage, the committee has not had sight of this amendment and so does not have a position on this. I note Amendment 8, relating to interpretation that is before us today, reflects the similar provision of the draft revised bill provided to us by officials. In its consideration, the committee was aware that further amendments would be required, and it was therefore not in a position to endorse the OFM-DFM proposals at that time and has not had the opportunity to consider the amendment being discussed today. Deputy Speaker, Amendment 9 is a new clause to the bill dealing with commencement. Amendment 10 amends the long title to reflect the changing nature of the bill. I can advise members that the committee has not had an opportunity to consider or come to a position on these amendments.
Call Ms. Megan Fearon.
Welcome the opportunity to speak to this important piece of legislation and indeed congratulate Mr. Agnew on getting it this far. Given that Amendment 5 is not being moved today, I don't foresee any major disagreements in terms of amendments, so hopefully after today we have a good bill going forward to further consideration stage where we can work together to improve it. We are very supportive of the principles behind this bill and its intentions. We all know that there is a lot of existing good practice when it comes to cooperations, and this bill and the amendments table seek to make that good practice systemic to achieve better outcomes for children and young people. We believe the amendments tabled by Stephen Agnew, myself and others will ensure better outcomes for children and young people. The statutory duty will bring a welcome focus to children and young people's needs and service delivery. Cooperation as it stands on children's issues is largely informal and dependent on relationships developed over time between relevant officials and workers. This means the degree of sharing across a range of children's services is varied. Placing requirements to cooperate in statute will ensure that the interests of children and young people are put first across all services and responsibilities. And of course, the most important people in all of this are our children and young people. Amendment 1, basically a new clause, specifically outlines the core aims and intent of this bill, which is essentially to support improvements of wellbeing of children and delivery of children's services, all with the benefit of the recipient of that service in mind. This new clause specifically defines wellbeing and makes links to the Children and Young People Strategy by way of the high-level outcomes listed. I have to say the links to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child are welcomed. I think it's a progressive step and an important in recognising children as rights bearers in their own right, which is too often ignored. In relation to Amendment 2 on the duty to cooperate in order to improve wellbeing, this is possibly the most important clause, if not one of the most important clauses within the bill. A statutory duty makes it easier for departments to come together to share resources and work collectively, basically to solidify what is already happening, but only on an ad hoc basis. Collaborative approaches to children's services will undoubtedly improve outcomes, remove duplication and ideally lead to budget savings as we try to make the best use of public funds available. The amendment very clearly states every children's authority must cooperate with other children's authorities and other children's service providers. This clause also allows for the executive to promote cooperation, and I know that Stephen has referred to this and Mike Nesbitt raised this earlier. I think concerns around that perhaps loose language have been assuaged as the title of the bill now places a requirement, and this clause states cooperation is clearly a must. In relation to Amendment 3 on the Children and Young Persons Strategy, the executive must adopt a strategy to improve the well-being of children and young people. And this amendment, in some ways but not all, obviously, does the job of Amendment 5, although that does need to be progressed, just given that it is so outcomes-focused. For example, the strategy must detail the outcomes that have to be met, what actions will be taken, how to determine the extent of the outcomes that have been achieved and when that should happen. And I'm particularly happy with reference in Amendment 3 that the executive must consult with actually children and young people. I think that's an important step in having their voices heard for services and service delivery that affects their lives, and obviously those who represent the views of children and young people as well. I think practically speaking, it is important that we ensure that a range of young people's voices are heard in that consultation from all socio-economic backgrounds in particular, and particularly those who are in most need and most vulnerable. In relation to Amendment 4, which is potentially another hugely important element of the bill, particularly in breaking down the silo mentality of departments, sharing resources and funds in this regard is basically common sense and can only really be described as a good thing if it's done properly. In the last debate, I made reference to delivering social change, which I believe is an excellent model for this. Its budget has come from all relevant departments in the delivery of signature projects, so this bill epitomises the spirit behind that practice. And I think this approach is almost a safeguard as well to ensure that no decisions will be taken to the detriment of core aims and of cooperation and the core aims of delivery for children. And I hope to see that practice spread across other departments and other areas, not necessarily just children's services. Moving on to Amendment 5, which Stephen had said was possibly the most complex and contentious to date. In terms of the original Clause 4, we wouldn't have been able to support that, and that was stated at the previous stage. It basically would have meant a transfer of control, in our opinion, of children's services to a non-departmental public body, which was already top-heavy and over-bureaucratic. I believe that original clause would have seen the usurpation of ministerial autonomy and taken away from democratic accountability rather than strengthen it. I think it's hugely important that ministers are able to retain the right to, and the ability to develop their own plans in accordance with their own priorities. And in relation to Amendment 5, I know it isn't being moved today, and we wouldn't have been able to support it in its original form in that particular version, but we are very happy to look at it in the future and come to an agreement on it, because it is an important part of the bill. One of our main concerns was in relation to subsection 9, which states it would repeal paragraph 2A of Schedule 2 of the Children's Order. This amendment would move duties currently placed on the Health and Social Care Board to the Executive, resulting in the Executive being responsible for the planning for the most vulnerable children and young people in our society. The Health and Social Care Board has statutory responsibilities for vulnerable children under the Children's Order, and it is important that that continues and they continue to plan for their needs. We and others have genuine concerns that very vulnerable children could be placed at risk by removing that responsibility from the Health and Social Care Board, although I do believe that result would have been unintentional, it's still a possibility. I think in relation to the strategy, it is appropriate that the Executive take responsibility for this document and set out its key objectives and aims across the board to improve the wellbeing of children and young people. However, for the actual services plan, it may be, and this is all up for discussion, it may be better drawn up and implemented by a single department or a single body that is more directly involved with children's services. But again, we can come to that at a later stage. Another issue that we had just with Amendment 5 in its current form was that one of the original intentions was to place the Children and Young People Strategic Partnership into statute, and this amendment didn't achieve that and doesn't appear anyway on the face of it to improve the effectiveness of that body. But these are all things that we can look at, and there's many ways that those can be progressed before the next stage of the bill, so we'd welcome the opportunity to engage further with Mr Agnew and other parties on that issue. Amendment 6 will be the last amendment that I'll address. The rest are pretty self-explanatory on reporting. A report must be produced every 3 years, detailing actions taken and progress gained on the agreed outcomes, as well as identifying further opportunities for cooperation and good practice, and I think that's an important part of it. And I'm aware that some may have wanted annual reports. However, I'm of the belief that the nature of reporting and the actual actions behind those reports are much more important than the frequency that reports are produced. Overall, I think with these amendments, this is a good bill and will make a positive contribution to our society and, most importantly, to the lives of children and young people. I think it's an important first step in changing mindsets and breaking down that silo mentality that I'm sure everyone in this chamber has been frustrated with at one point or another. I would actually like to see the rollout of this collaborative approach to other areas, such as job creation, tackling poverty, as it ensures that the outcome is kept to the fore of each department's decision-making process. So Sinn Féin will be supporting these amendments proposed, obviously, with the exception of Amendment 5, which won't be moved now. And just again to congratulate Stephen Agnew on this bill, and we hope to see the positive impact that this bill is capable of having in the near future.
Call Mr Alex Atwood.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. Could I first of all, as is always the case when it comes to private members' bill, acknowledge its primary sponsor and mover in Stephen Agnew. If you look at the narrative around private members' bill in this chamber, arguably it is one of those areas where the chamber has shown its greatest authority, or certainly a lot of good authority, when you consider the bills that have been tabled or been passed in this and previous mandates. And this piece of legislation is no different in that regard. And therefore, Stephen in particular, or Stephen Agnew in particular, and all those who have worked with him, and I'll refer to that in a second, they need to be acknowledged and affirmed, not least in this vital policy area, with this very important part of our community. It does, of course, the bill in its very nature and character does make a statement about our government. And the statement that it makes about our government is that it is too dispersed, it is too silo in its approach, it doesn't adopt a coherent, cohesive and integrated approach. If you look, as I always tend to do, look to the Government of Scotland, which is the best government in these islands, which was advertised by its success in the Westminster election and confirmed by its success in terms of the campaign around Scottish independence. They have a very fluid approach to government and to government departments. They don't have this silo approach where ministers work and don't relate as fully and effectively to other ministers, other departments, as they might. And that's only one example of what we should learn from the Scottish Government in terms of how they conduct ministerial and departmental work. It is a fluid approach. Also, there's echoes in this bill and in the comments made by Stephen Agnew of something the SDLP argued for and succeeded in securing in an earlier mandate, namely executive programme funds, which was a model that recognised that there were issues that by their character were either of such priority or of such diversity that you needed to have an executive programme approach as opposed to a singular departmental approach. And in that regard, given the clauses in the bill, even the clauses in respect of pooling of resources, that does demonstrate that there is models within this bill that have application to policy areas away beyond this bill in terms of pooling of resources and pooling of approach. Could I share the proposer's comments in respect of FMDFM? It was my concern that once this bill had been tabled, that it would go into the bureaucratic system and it would either not emerge or emerge in a much changed format. And Mr. Agnew will confirm the conversations I had in terms of worse fears on that, in that regard. And maybe even some tensions within the Office of First Deputy First Minister may have gotten in the way of impeding the ambition and the scale of this bill. But as Mr. Agnew rightly pointed out, the experience of working with AFM and DFM and with the officials has been to work this up and to then get it over the line. And it is not the failure of the office or of its officials that Mr. Agnew rightly made the decision to bring this bill to the chamber this time, given the uncertainty around our political institutions. I want to recognise the good authority shown by people in FM and DFM in respect of the response to Mr. Agnew's bill, and to also acknowledge what Mr. Agnew did in terms of the children's sector. As he said, this is their bill, and whilst he's the sponsor and the mover and the architect in terms of legislative terms, the ambition and the need and the policy intent in this bill comes from the children's sector, and I do think we need to acknowledge that, as Mr. Agnew also acknowledged the work of the Bills Office. It is always the case in the last year of a mandate that the floor of the Assembly or the floor of any legislative chamber in these islands can get very busy and very crowded, and that places particular burdens upon the Bills Office, a burden that I have to say, in the event that our institutions continue for the residue of its mandate, a burden on the Bills Office is going to become more intense, as given the work to rule that we experience at the moment, and we see again that there's nobody on the benches opposite from the Democratic Unionist Party. Nobody. No one. There was one person there earlier, and that person has now absented themselves, maybe for good reason, I don't know. But the burden that's going to fall to the Bills Office in the event that we get through the current negotiations and that the institutions continue their full mandate, the burden on the Bills Office will become more intense, and we need to acknowledge that as we move forward. The policy content of this document is actually being corroborated and advertised over the last couple of weeks, where be it the churches in Northern Ireland or be it DSD, they have both spoken to and gave huge evidence in relation to the scale of poverty in Northern Ireland and relative poverty in Northern Ireland and the poverty of our children in particular. And that, in my view, is the policy background, in fact, the policy foreground, that it should be around this bill. Because if we want to have cooperation when it comes to children's and young people's services, the first task of that cooperation must be to address the objective circumstances experienced by children and young people, by children in particular, not least in respect of the scale of relative poverty. So this is what DSD confirmed last week. And I make this point not just in respect of the content of this bill, but in respect of the content of the talks that continue a matter of a few hundred yards from here in Stormont House, because these figures have relevance to this bill, but they have relevance to these negotiations, and that they should inform this bill and that they should inform these negotiations for reasons that are going to be clear in a second. So what did DSD confirm just last week? That in the last year of record, 2013-14, 376,000 people remained in Northern Ireland on relatively low incomes, with average household income dropping by 1%. And then, among the households, 213,000 working-age adults and 63,000 pensioners were living on the breadline. And that when you probe further into the 376,000 people on relatively low incomes, the child poverty figure was 23%, or 101,000 people, up from 20% the previous year. So according to our own government, according to the DSD department, child poverty is up from 20% to 23% in a year, with over 100,000 children now living in child poverty. And as one of the children's charities said, that's expected to rise even further. And it is, because there was an ambition to get child poverty down over the lifetime of this mandate and up to 2020. And yet the figures are suggesting, and some people dispute some of these figures, but they're all going in the wrong direction, even if you dispute the conclusion of those figures. And some of the figures suggest from the IFS that relative and absolute child poverty will be above 30% against both levels by 2020. So here we are in 2015, where we're up from 20% to 23% against one of the indicators in the last year, and the evidence indicates that it's going in the wrong direction over the next 4 or 5 years. That is the policy content that is at the back of in my view, is one of the features that is the foreground or the background to the content of this bill. And it is, in my view, should be in the foreground of what is going down in terms of the negotiations a few hundred yards from here. Because quite a number of us are getting weary of the single transferable speech coming from the Secretary of State and Treasury about no more money, when we have much more poverty. And whether it is an issue about money for welfare or more money for work, then will London get it into their heads that the ambition of this bill and the scale of child poverty in Northern Ireland is going to be damaged and undermined if the London government does not fully understand the scale of the issues that we face when it comes to child poverty and the scale of response that is required to protect people, those in poverty, be it children or families, and to help those children get work when they grow up and get their parents to have work here and now. And that's what London needs to recognise, that we are trying to legislate for our particular circumstances, where London is trying to damage our ability to tackle those particular circumstances. And the Children's Commissioner, writing in the Belfast Telegraph over the last number of days, actually, in fact 2 days ago, or yesterday was it, said the following: "The highest levels of child poverty and mental ill health are in those areas most impacted upon by the conflict. Our children experience unacceptably high rates of mental health, with more children in Northern Ireland dying through suicide than anywhere else on these islands." Now, in the talks, it has been the leader of the Old Students' Party who has made the point about the issue of a mental trauma centre and the needs of our people when it comes to mental trauma, remembering that 1 in 10 of our people are on incapacity benefits, whereas in Britain it is 1 in 5. No, it's not. It's 1 in 20. Mr. Deputy Speaker. Our scale of people on incapacity is twice what it is in Britain, whatever those figures actually look like. And when you then interrogate those figures somewhat further, then you see the highest levels of child poverty and mental health in those areas impacted by the conflict. So not only does it have to be a domestic response in terms of our government in a joined-up way, the London government needs to recognise that if we're to deal with the trauma of our conflict, including the good proposals that are coming forward in respect of mental trauma, where I think there's probably unanimity across all the parties in the negotiations, then they need to work through that if they want to help us deal with the legacy of our conflict, and they say they do, and they have today shared with the various parties elements of the bill to be tabled in the House of Commons in respect of dealing with the past at an institutional level, then they also need to recognise that we need to deal with it in a practical level, and that includes dealing with the issues of the highest levels of child poverty and mental health in those areas impacted by the conflict. If we are to deal with our child poverty issue, we also have to deal with our issues, emotional stress and difficulties being experienced by our children in terms of the talks. And to conclude that argument, I want to quote from what the church leaders said last week. And they said, the unacceptable level of child poverty affecting over 100,000 children, roughly 6% of Northern Ireland's population, constitutes a real crisis. Supports that have been proved to be effective in recent years in addressing inequality and closing the gaps in crucial areas such as educational disadvantage are now being withdrawn through lack of funding. The failure to invest adequately in the future leaders of our society is a cause of deep frustration among young people, leaving many feeling disconnected from political processes. London should hear that, and that this bill is an effective response to that narrative, because by having joined up government across departments and by putting life on the various clauses of the bill, you will end up with addressing what the church leaders recognised last week as, to use their words, a real crisis. Mr. Deputy Speaker, could I just make some passing comments in respect of the amendments that have been brought forward? In respect of Amendment 1, new clause, this is where the bill defines the well-being of children and young persons, and in that regard makes reference to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. I think that's a wise approach to state on the face of legislation, especially by reference to international codes, what it is the ambition of a piece of legislation, in this instance the well-being of children and young persons. I believe that that actually should be part and parcel of the legislation that was shared with the parties this morning in relation to international and European standards, Article 2, rights under the European Convention in respect of how the legacy mechanism, the HIU, should conduct affairs. So could I acknowledge that model of putting on the face of bill the ambition of a bill by reference to international convention, as well as defining what the nature of the issue and the challenge is, as new Clause 1 would do. In respect of Clause 2, at an earlier stage, the SDLP and I made comment about our concern about the words in new Clause 1B in relation to as far as is consistent with the proper exercise of the children's functions. And I would look to the sponsor in his reply to confirm that language doesn't limit what is intended to be the ambition of the bill, and in anticipation of confirmation that that is the case and that that is not a word that dilutes or limits the ambition of that particular clause, we'll be supporting the clause. I will.
Yes, this is a phrase that I know the committee had its own, I suppose, legal advice, additional scrutiny from Daniel Greenberg, and indeed I met with him, and certainly he referred to it as I'm trying to remember his term, but I remember the word heffalump was used as a word, avoidance heffalump or something like that. I did try to seek other opinions and did seek get reassurances from other legal opinions that this was normal practice in drafting, and that it wasn't simply a loophole through which the department could escape. So in that regard, I was content. I did wait to see if any other amendments would come forward to seek that out, but I'm guessing that whilst there are concerns about it, people are content that it is normal practice.
Certainly we're reassured by that, and reassured by if people who've been drafted the other clauses in the bill seem to be shaping them in an expansive and positive way, then I'm reassured that other words that might be open to interpretation won't be interpreted in a negative and a limited way. In respect, Mr. Deputy Speaker, Amendment 3, new clause, where there is the executive must adopt a strategy. This is a critical clause. Irrespective of the fact that there was a previous strategy, this is a critical clause, not least because of the decision of the High Court in July in relation to the failure of AFM and DFM to adopt a an anti-poverty strategy. So when the Committee of Administrations took a judicial review of the conduct of the Office of First Minister and Deputy First Minister in that regard, where it is my understanding, subject to correction, it's my understanding that the argument of the Office of First and Deputy First Minister was that the programme for government was an anti-poverty strategy. That rather than adopt a dedicated anti-poverty strategy, the programme for government was somehow the anti-poverty strategy. An argument, if I am correct, in that argument that was rejected by the High Court when they required the Office of FMDFM to adopt an anti-poverty strategy. And therefore, this clause that shapes an anti-poverty strategy and the process around all of that is very important given that High Court ruling in respect of a related matter. Could I then move to Amendment 4, new clause, where Stephen Agnew in his opening contribution made the point that this is the place in the bill where the bill moves from process and moves to product. And this is a pivotal clause in the bill, because whatever legislation says and whatever its ambition might be, and there's so much in this bill that is good, unless there is the resources to do the work and pooling of resources, then we could end up with either limited outcomes or less joined up outcomes. So critical to the ambition of this bill is the implementation of this clause when it comes to a pooling of resources, because if departments, especially in times of limited resources, protect and don't pool, then the bill could end up being frustrated. Could I also acknowledge Amendment 5, the Children and Young Persons Plan, noting that this is not to be moved, because this clause, the Children and Young Persons Plan provision, is where the processes are given a dynamism, because you can have the best processes, but at the end of that you need the best plans with the best follow-up of resources, including pool resources, and this makes dynamic the ambition of the bill. And the clause, Amendment 6, new clause, reporting the operation of the Act, is also critical, because unless there's accountability, And I note that it's been said that a report might come forward more than every 3 years. In my view, in the early life of this new duty, it will have to come forward more regularly than every 3 years. Because my experience in government is that there will be a natural resistance to the ambition of this legislation, be it to have joined up approach when it comes to policy or the pooling of resources when it comes to practice. There will be a resistance. And if some who may resist only think they have to account every 3 years, or a minister thinks that he only has to account every 3 years, then that, in my view, especially in the early life of this new legislative responsibilities, could frustrate what it is that the bill, its authors and the sector has wanted. But subject to all those comments, Mr Deputy Speaker, this in the days that are in it, when ministers are in and out, when members are in and out of the chamber, and I acknowledge that there could be very good reasons in respect of Mr Moutry, so it's not a personal criticism in that regard, it's more a party criticism in general. This is actually the Assembly showing its good authority, and government and government officials showing good authority. And more than anything else, the children's sector, on behalf of who they advocate for, showing the very best of authority. And that's why I hope that even if it was the case that this Assembly was to go into adjournment or go into an election or whatever it might be, that before that day and hour comes, that this bill gets through all its processes, so that at this time of turbulence, the Assembly shows good authority. And if there is to be more turbulence, and I don't believe that there will be, and I trust that there won't be, then perhaps it would be a willing conclusion to this mandate that a piece of legislation in its latter days was passed that responded to the human condition and the needs of those who are most vulnerable in our society, children in poverty.
I call Mr. Chris Little.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to respond to this stage of the Children's Services Cooperation Bill. The Lands Party has had a long-standing manifesto commitment to support a statutory duty to cooperate on executive departments as part of our commitment to step forward for better government in Northern Ireland, so I have been glad to support the principles of this bill to introduce a statutory duty to cooperate on Northern Ireland departments with regards to achieving better outcomes for the wellbeing of children and young people in our society. And indeed, I was glad to proactively engage with the committee stage of this bill, where we gathered a significant amount of evidence to support and progress the bill to this stage, and indeed to welcome the contribution of OFM-DFM in terms of presenting a revised draft of the bill to the committee, with which the committee was broadly content, and indeed as was the Office for First and Deputy First Minister. It's regrettable, therefore, that a full final draft was not presented by OFM-DFM, and indeed, therefore, for the Executive to have a full opportunity to respond to that final draft. And indeed, it's regrettable that we don't have full party and ministerial response to this stage of the bill today. To be honest, Deputy Speaker, failed to see how ministerial resignation or ministerial boycott is doing what's right for Northern Ireland, given the opportunities that we have in this Assembly and at the Executive table to deal collectively with some of the difficult challenges facing our society in Northern Ireland, not least endeavouring to improve the outcomes for children and young people. So it's not ideal that we don't have that final draft, but or for us to be at this stage today, but I appreciate the proposing members' desire to see progress on this important bill, and I'm glad that we do have an opportunity to respond to that today. I do believe that improved cooperation is needed on many issues in our society, early intervention in health and education, the delivery of a shared and prosperous society, but absolutely to improve the well-being of children and young people. And cooperation is vital in any government, but perhaps most particularly in a multi-party executive. And we do have some positive examples of cooperation in our executive. Parties might not be surprised to hear me cite Alliance Ministries in the Department of Justice and the Department for Employment and Learning in terms of work being done to improve learning outcomes at Hyde Bank Wood Secure Offenders Facility, and indeed to recognise the DRD Cycling Unit cooperation with the Department of Health Public Health Agency work to pool resources in order to improve the active school travel programme, which has had positive outcomes for children and young people in terms of active travel. But in terms of the amendments that we're considering today, Mr Deputy Speaker, I welcome those that have been put forward. I think Amendment 1 sets out good high-level outcomes to be monitored and to be achieved as part of the bill. Physical and mental health, the enjoyment of play and leisure, learning and achievement, living in safety, economic and environmental well-being, the enablement to make a positive contribution to society, and living in a society which respects the rights of children and young people. These are all issues that I have worked on as a member of this Assembly, indeed worked with the proposer, Stephen Agnew, on the All-Party Group for Children and Young People, and indeed it has been a pleasure to work closely with the children's sector in relation to all those issues. I welcome the placement of the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child on the face of the bill, as other members have, and indeed the opportunity that any amendments to those high-level outcomes would require the positive approval of this Assembly and full consultation of the Assembly. I welcome, therefore, Amendment 2, also the key amendment of the bill in terms of the introduction of the statutory duty to cooperate, and indeed the provisions that are being made for all children's authorities to cooperate together on those key high-level outcomes. In terms of Amendment 3, Mr Deputy Speaker, I think this is also a positive inclusion in the bill to put the adoption of a children and young person strategy on the face of the bill, and also to ensure that that achieves specific outcomes, that it has specific actions, and indeed that that is achieved within specific timescales. Amendment 4, Mr Deputy Speaker, in terms of the sharing of resources and pooling of funds, is something that I support. Indeed, I have asked a number of questions of OFM, DFM to seek update in relation to work that they have done in terms of children's budgeting, and I think that will be a positive provision in the final law that comes forward. Amendment 5, the proposer of the bill has said that he is willing to reflect on that particular provision, and I will therefore do the same if and when that returns at further consideration stage. Amendment 6, Mr Deputy Speaker, I think is a very important amendment in terms of ensuring robust reporting as to progress on the work that will be carried out as part of the bill and the new law when it becomes forward. I think there can be no more important task for an executive than to report to the public on whether or not it is achieving what it has said it is going to achieve. I think we could improve drastically the executive's reporting on the programme for government in general, and I'm glad that such specific reporting mechanisms are being included in this bill in relation to children and young people. The other amendments then, Mr Deputy Speaker, are all positive amendments as well. In terms of Amendment 8, with regards to defining ages around children and young people, I think it is important that we do appear to have provision for that age category to be stretched to up to 21 under particular categories. I think that was one particular piece of evidence that was given at committee stage, that transitionary period between 18, 21, 23 and 25 can be an extremely important period for some of the most vulnerable children and young people in our community, and I welcome that on the face of the bill there is provision for duty to cooperate for those particularly key age groups. So, Mr. Deputy Speaker, in conclusion then, I do think it's absolutely essential that this Assembly requires the Executive to coordinate services and to maximise resources as effectively as possible, particularly on behalf of children and young people in our community. We have heard stark warnings from the Institute of Fiscal Studies, from the UN, and today from statistics presented by DSD with regards to the growing issue of child poverty. And the UN has warned that the failure to achieve positive outcomes for children is one of the most costly mistakes that a society can make. I certainly hope that this bill will go some way to ensure that we don't make that mistake in Northern Ireland and that we can deliver for our children and young people. Thank you.
Well, Mr. Chris Hazard.
And I welcome the opportunity to speak here today on this, what I believe certainly is a very transformative bill. Like Dahi Mackay's private member's bill on the plastic bag levy, which had a very transformative effect for our environment and as society approaches our use and how we approach recycling. I think this bill will hopefully have a very transformative effect on the delivering for children's services right across government. So I congratulate Stephen Agnew for bringing it forward. For the children's sector as a whole, I think this is a great win for the children and young person sector, and indeed for the working of the OFM DFN committee. And Mike Nesbitt, the chair, outlined some of the work that they have done to date on reporting and working through a variety of the issues. I suppose coming to this bill recently, you know, I've looked through a lot of the reporting and some of this work done by the OFM DFM committee, and it's quite clear that the stakeholders out there, the sector out there, have big things to say. And they're unanimous in their approach to this. You know, the Health and Social Care Board have said that more can be done when it comes to cooperation. NSPCC said, where a policy issue crosses several government departments and their remits, it becomes increasingly difficult to progress in terms of determining leadership and priority. NILGA said that much work needs to be done to overcome the silo approach to work towards a single outcome. And the Commissioner for Children and Young People talked at great lengths and right throughout all the reports of the extent of the barriers that are there for children and their services. And I think it's really at the heart of this issue is about putting children first and putting the rights of children first. You know, too long government process have focused on the interests of institutions at the expense of the rights of the child. You know, I think of the ongoing educational reforms, such as the upcoming Special Educational Needs and Disability Bill, coupled with this private member's bill, is crucial in finally giving children and young people a say in their own personal journey and that of all children and young people in our society. You know, for too long, the management and configuration of vital services, you know, such as health, such as education, have not taken into effect the need to strategically plan, deliver and evaluate to meet the needs of all the children and young people in our society. Like what much of government does, this silo mentality of departments and their agencies has remained an incorrigible barrier to progress. This has undoubtedly led to a huge duplication of services in recent decades, and with the ever-increasing pressures on the public purse, there's a real and urgent need to explore ways in which we can collaborate between departments and deliver across agencies, and I think that this bill does this. It's wrong, of course, to suggest that relationships and the sharing hasn't developed extensively in recent times, but I think we've reached a point of solidifying these partnerships and putting concrete expectations in place to build upon the good practice that has indeed flourished. Turning to the amendments, I think it's fair to say that Amendment 1 captures the spirit and the intent of the bill. You know, it really focuses upon the centrality of the child. I think it's hugely welcome to see the link with the UN Convention on Rights of the Child. This is a very welcome step. I think, and I've outlined already, far too often institutions neglect the fact that the children are rights bearers, you know, that they are the ones that bear the rights in this regard. And I think to bring this into the bill is a very welcome step indeed. And if Amendment 1 captures the spirit, I suppose, of the bill, I think it's fair to say Amendment 2 goes to the very heart of the issue. You know, from moving from this permissive notion that cooperation to requiring collaboration between departments, I think it's going to be a very transformative step indeed. It's going to be a real game changer, and I think indeed it's all throughout the stakeholders will indeed welcome it. Again, I think that having the Children and Young Person Strategy with Amendment 3 is to be welcomed. And I think one of the most important facts of this, and we've seen this again through deliberations of the Committee for Education on the Special Educational Needs, is this consulting with the children. We must begin to put the child right at the centre of everything we do, and I think this amendment certainly looks at that. And again, if I continue with the analogy with the spirit and the heart, I think Amendment 4 will be the engine for real change when it comes to the sharing of resources and the pooling of funds. You know, no doubt, yes, it's important that we get a more efficient use of public funds, but I think what is vital here is a realisation of the hopes of many families when it comes to the services for their children. You know, this is going to be a catalyst for real and welcome reform in government. I think it's going to build upon the good practice. We see it with delivering social change programmes, and this development can undoubtedly make a real difference to children and their families. You know, I came across an issue in my own constituency lately when it came to meeting the needs of special educational needs of a particular child. And along the one road in the Mourns area, one education authority will fully cost and meet the needs of a child with autism, and at the other end of that road, a different education authority will not meet the needs, and that family will have to pay to meet the needs. You know, this is an absolutely disgraceful situation, a situation that is now remedied, of course, with the establishment of the education authority, but it highlights the need for government departments and agents and their agencies to work together. You know, no family should ever have to go through such a circumstance, and I think, again, that the outworkings of this bill will give us a great opportunity to relegate them sort of stories to the past. I welcome the fact that Amendment 5 is not going to be moved. I think it gives its time to bridge the gaps and to certainly work in partnership again going forward. Turning to Amendment 6, and the last amendment I'll touch upon, I think what's important when it comes to reporting is the quality, it's not the quantity. I would like to see very innovative and a diverse approach to how we report and how we come back. I think we need to see as well from government a rich diversity in how we use the information that's, which is gathered. And again, I think this has the scope to do this. As I say, I'll not touch upon Amendment 7 or 8. But just in concluding, as I say, I think this is a well-deserved win for all those who work within the children and young persons sector. As I've outlined, it's a real game-changer. But not just, I think, for children and young people, but if done right, this will provide a template, I think, right across government of how best practice can be rolled out. I have no doubt that these issues that we've dealt here today will go on to really inspire those people who work in the sector and prove great improvement. But again, I think it's about rolling it out. There's no reason why this model can't help us tackle environmental issues, the need to build a more socially just economy, and indeed issues to do with education in a more holistic and joined-up way also. So overall, I welcome the bill at this stage. I'll call on all parties to support the amendments and to continue working on a partnership approach. I think this befits the very nature of what we're discussing here today. Colm Milgett.
Call Mrs. Sandra Overend.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I would like to commend Mr. Agnew for getting the bill to the stage. It has behind it noble aims and worthy objectives. And although I'm not a member of the OFM-DFM committee which has scrutinised this bill, but as Ulster Unionist spokesperson for children and young people, I have a keen interest in this piece of legislation. The bill, as Mr. Agnew has pointed out, is for the benefit of all children in Northern Ireland. It is to increase efficiency of service through effective cooperation to ensure better outcomes for children and young people in Northern Ireland. The lack of cooperation and joined-up government has shown to be of detriment to the people of Northern Ireland time and time again, but with issues relating to children, failings in their early years have the potential to have an effect on the rest of their lives. My party colleague, Mike Nesbitt, has spoken before of the silo mentality in government, as have a number of those who gave evidence to the OFM-DFM committee on this bill. The ability to cut across departments and work horizontally is essential for effective policy delivery, and at present there is a concerning lack of this type of cooperation. As Dr. Alison Montgomery of NICCYP, speaking about this bill in her evidence to the OFM-DFM committee, said, "Children cannot divide their needs across departments as we currently have them." Indeed, the Commissioner herself noted, "Not having a duty to cooperate has thwarted the full realisation of children's rights and effective services." As a constituency MLA, I have been dealing with numerous cases where children are experiencing difficulties in getting health and education authorities to take action and deliver the care to which they are entitled. And I'm sure other MLAs are experiencing that in their own daily work. We have many powerful examples of how government departments when left to their own devices, can often revert to the instinct of seeking to pass the buck to others and hoping that a problem will go away. Likewise, in my own pursuit of the development of a cross-departmental internet safety strategy, unfortunately, I know only too well how such an important issue can be dealt with like a hot potato. These attitudes are exactly why I'm particularly drawn to the intent of the bill to ensure that each Northern Ireland department must cooperate with the other departments so as to further the achievement of the specified outcomes. The consultation carried out regarding this bill received overwhelming support, and I understand that the vast majority of the amendments before us today have received broad support prior to their introduction today, and I welcome that and the groundwork done by Mr. Agnew. This bill is aimed at all children and in essence is hoped to be a preventative mechanism. It is about creating a culture of cooperation so that all departments have a role and all children benefit from the very beginning of their lives. This is a forward-thinking idea. However, the question is whether legislation is needed to create this culture, and if so, will this piece of proposed legislation be effective in that regard? The problem, which has been noted time and time again, is the silo mentality of our departments. Will this legislation, if enacted, provide the basis for a better system of cooperation between departments? It is difficult to say, especially without clear set-out sanctions outside judicial review, although that does seem the only reasonable and appropriate sanction available. The original bill sought to put the government's six high-level outcomes from its children's strategy into legislation and establish a requirement for departments to discharge their functions and cooperate to further the achievements of these outcomes. The bill, as amended, focuses more on the legal definition of well-being of children and young people. I believe in its current state the bill would create, at the very least, a floor of cooperation below which the departments must not fall. The Children and Young People Strategy, the guidance on reports on the operation of the Act, and the guidance available to children's authorities from OFM, DFM, should allow a strong degree of clarity to those bodies which are to cooperate and ensure effective work towards positive outcomes. And I look forward to further amendments on the plan as per Amendment 5, which I believe is not being moved. However, I'm slightly concerned at the phrase in Clause 1, Part 2 of Amendment 2, where it's stated the Executive must make arrangements to promote cooperation of the kind mentioned in Subsection 2. I know that this was discussed in committee, and it was noted that using the word promote rather than advance or achieve was easier to measure. However, as with DETI in recent years, where many jobs have been promoted but less realised, I feel that this could harm the efficacy of the proposals. There is also a degree of flexibility permitted by the clauses in this bill which would allow areas of weakness and any effective plans and strategies to be amended with proper oversight from the Assembly. Again, this seems to strike the right balance. Permitting a pooling of funding and sharing of other resources, although not a legal requirement in this bill, would allow a flexible method of cooperation. Mr. Agnew has pointed out the hope that through the required departmental cooperation, this pooling of resources will happen organically. This is a vital aspect of this bill, and a lot rests on the successful pooling of resources to ensure both efficiency savings in the long run, but also the effective implementation of strategies to improve outcomes for children and young people. This will be a true test of these proposals. Mr. Deputy Speaker, in conclusion, it is important that cross-departmental work is successful, not only across ministers, but also across government officials and workers in the various government departments. We do need this, and this bill holds the right tools to ensure effective delivery, and we will be supporting it. And it is up to all parties in the executive to use it to the benefit of the people of Northern Ireland. Thank you.
Call Mr. Roy Beggs.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I firstly like to declare an interest in this area. I'm the current chair of the Carrickfergus Children and Young People's Locality Group, who works with a range of both government agencies and the voluntary sector in this area, and feeds into the Northern Children and Young People's Partnership, linked to the Children and Young People's Strategic Partnership. I'm also a committee member of Horizon Sure Start, which tries to assist expectant mothers and mothers with parents with children of age 0 to 4 to try and help them in their early years. A BP officer then as well, and a governor in Glen Primary School. So I have a general interest in this area and feel it is very, very important. I'm also minded in terms of this area of information that I received regarding Professor James Heckmond about the importance of investing in the young. And one of the things that I can see in this bill is to try and avoid duplication. And when you look at the amendments that are being listed, it is requiring cooperation and to try and get better value for money of the investment that does happen. And in that, I am supportive of the bill and its amendments that have come forward, because not only do we have to invest more in the young, but we have to make better use of the money that we do invest. I'd like to thank Stephen for his efforts to date, because I think it is the right direction of travel. The detailed engagement that Mr. New has made with officials and indeed the committee, I think has helped to refine the bill, and I can see in his amendments that he is still trying to achieve the original objectives, but perhaps in a more practical and workable fashion by altering the wording. Turning to amendment number one, the idea of trying to improve children's well-being, I think that is important, and to look at a wide range of activities. I do note that in subsection 1A, part 3, that there is that the in determining the meaning of well-being for the purpose of the Act, regard is to be had for any relevant provisions in the United Nations Convention for the Rights of the Child. And I personally think that is the correct wording. I think regard has to be given to them, but not necessarily slavishly follow everything that is there. So I am content with that wording. If there is international good practice, we should be trying to follow it, but we should not be following everything slavishly. We have to satisfy ourselves that it does make sense ourselves here as well. Turning to Amendment 2, requiring cooperation between different authorities working with children and young people. This is essential, and from my previous experience in working in this area, I've come across some quite surprising things. Originally, I got drawn into educational underachievement, not through the Department of Education, but believe it or not, through Northern Health and Social Services Board, Children and Young People's Planning section, who were concerned with levels of exclusion and suspensions and indeed absenteeism within parts of my constituency. And it was very surprising that it was the Department of Health was appreciating the long-term adverse effect that this could have on children and young people, and the need frequently for a range of services and support to intervene, not just the school, but that there is a need for a wide variety of bodies to work in a coordinated fashion. There can be a range of interventions that public bodies can make when families get into crisis. Sometimes that crisis is shown by, as I say, the child's behaviour and perhaps lack of attendance at school. But there can be involvement from social services. There can be involvement from the Department of Health. There can be involvement from Education and Welfare Service, from the Department of Justice. And it is very important that we do not have a wide variety of engagements, because again, you can potentially not have a consistent message, or you may have multiple people engaging with an individual, which again does not bring about the best results. Generally, in my experience, it's important that there is coordinated working between the range of officials who are trying to assist a family, and that there is someone taking the lead coordinating all that information that is required to bring about the best outcomes. So I certainly agree that there is a need for close working between all the departments and that this is an important method of direction. And some of that engagement can bring about very dramatic improvements, both in the short term and the long term. I think in terms of the Action for Children Choices programme, whereby engagement with families where children were seen to be at risk of offending brought about dramatic improvements in the family situation. Additional parenting skills would be given, boundaries would be given, consistent parenting would become much, much better. Children's attendance at school would once again improve. And it is important that this type of work continues in a coordinated fashion, not from multiple government officials, but in an efficient way that brings about the best outcome. So I am generally content with the remainder of the amendments. With regard to Amendment 5, I too welcome the decision of the member not to press it at this stage. I think if there are practical discussions that are needed to perhaps further refine, etc., to try and bring about improvement and to enable it to cross the line, I think that is a wise decision. And I hope that the time between this section of the bill and what I hope to be the next section of the bill will not be too long, and that the bill can be finalised and come into statute. Thank you.
Call Mr. John McAllister, and could I inform the member that if his contribution extends beyond 1 o'clock, I will have to interrupt him for the business committee that meets at that time.
Deputy Speaker, normally when people assure the House that they're not going to take long, they usually go on and do exactly that, but I think on this occasion I can stay with some degree of certainty. I'd like, Deputy Speaker, first of all, to congratulate the work that Mr. Agnew has put in to the bill and the engagement generally around to get the bill to this stage. I welcome, of course, the change in direction that the bill has took during its committee stage and coming out here at consideration stage. A few points that may be useful, and I apologise for not being able to stay for the first part of his wine speech, but a few of the points that I just note in making, say, economic and environmental wellbeing, and in making making them by positive contribution to society. I'm just slightly concerned as to how we, Deputy Speaker, measure that, or how government would measure such a thing. I do welcome the lack of that. I welcome the play and the enjoyment of play and leisure. I'm someone that's no secret. I've long been an advocate that I would like to see, particularly with new powers in our councils, I'd like to see them all developing basically a play park strategy, and particularly with all of their community planning. I would like to see much more emphasis on the importance of that and local government trying to deliver. I'm just a little concerned. I would like some maybe ideas from Mr. Agnew as to how he sees that being measured, nor are we creating something in legislation that we quite frankly may not ever be able to achieve, and that laudable knowledge as the goal and the anticipation of it might be. The other clause in the changes direction, I too, like Mr. Beggs, welcome the member not moving Amendment 5 and that new clause, and I think it will be interesting to see at further consideration stage as to what that develops into and what that looks like, the work that he's done. And the other point, I think it was the chair of the committee made the point about the lack of sanctions, and that, Deputy Speaker, is a worry to me, given the nature and how good our government is at delivering on things. as to whether we need to look and seriously think about, do we build in some form of sanction if government doesn't measure up to this, that the only recourse that there is almost taking departments to court to grant or to try and exercise it. Is there some other sanction or mechanism that we can do? Deputy Speaker, on the broad or policy debate that we've had round this amended bill in this consideration stage, I think there's a huge onus, and Mr. Agnew touched on it in his opening remarks, is there's a huge onus on how this place does its business and the actual ability of an executive of a government to formulate an agreed policy agenda. There's an onus and an emphasis on political parties to come up with a agreed and with policy agendas, sometimes quite and not always be passing the buck. I've heard others, Mr. Atwood talked about our child poverty figures, and always looking to London and blaming what's happened in London and blaming what other governments are doing. But sometimes forgetting that he is in government and in a party that is in government, and it is incumbent of all those that do hold office in the executive arm of this assembly that they formulate government policy, agreed government policy, to actually tackle the very issues that Mr. Agnew is wanting to see and his bill is driving to do, of a collective approach in dealing with children's issues and children's services, children and young people, and how we deal and how we best get those innovative policy advancements, instead of always at times cutting those at very times when we need them the most, the early interventions that many of us speak about but we don't seem to be able to deliver. But on this occasion, I wish Mr. Agnew well on the passage on this stage, the passage of the bill, and certainly will be voting in support of him and his advice on these amendments. Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
Order. The Business Committee has arranged to meet at 1 p.m. today. I therefore propose my leave of the Assembly to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. The sitting is by leave suspended. Thank you.
We now return to the consideration stage of the Children's Services Cooperation Bill, and I call Mr. Stephen Agnew to conclude and wind the debate. Mr. Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I'd like to thank all the members who contributed to today's debate. I believe the spirit of the debate so far has reflected the process in getting the bill to this stage. It's been cooperative and it has been constructive. I will speak to some of the comments on each of the amendments and then conclude just by reflecting on some of members' contributions. Coming to Amendment 1, there was a broad welcome for the inclusion of the regard being paid to the UNCRC in defining wellbeing, particularly from Megan Fearon and Alex Atwood. And indeed, Roy Beggs welcomed the language of regard to it and iterated the point that it should be regard rather than slavishly follow. That said, he welcomed the benefit that regard to the UNCRC could bring, and where we could look internationally for good practice, we should do that. The only concern that was drawn, raised around Amendment 1 was how do we measure the outcomes, and this was raised by John McAllister, and he made specific reference to measuring economic and environmental well-being of children and whether they're positively contributing to society. And throughout my research in this bill, measuring outcomes, and we looked a lot at the Children's Act 2004, UK Children's Act 2004, and it had similar high-level outcomes enshrined in the bill. And they are, by their very nature, outcomes difficult to measure particularly when you're looking at outcomes for children and looking at generational outcomes and changes. So the measurement, even in the research of a historical piece of legislation, such as the 2004 Act, is to some extent inconclusive, though there are many indicators used. What I would say is the outcomes were those used in the children's strategy, the 10-year strategy for children and young people, and they are outcomes that the departments are used to assessing, and in that regard don't deviate from work that's already being done within departments. So whilst I don't think you can definitively answer questions around outcomes, you can measure indicators as to whether or not the travel is in the right direction, and that's how I would anticipate the reporting to take place on those outcomes. Amendment 2, the Chair of the Committee, Mike Nesbitt, raised the issue as to whether promote the executive requirement to promote cooperation was sufficient, and whether or not the term advance perhaps would be stronger. I said in my opening comments that I was content with the language because it is an absolute requirement on children's authorities to cooperate. The word is must. The promotion of cooperation by the executive was additional to wording that was in the original draft of the bill, so in that regard I was supportive because it went further than the original bill. However, that said, now that the issue has been raised, and I know it was raised by stakeholders, I will seek advice as to whether or not that does further the bill. One of the things I've learned through this process is sometimes words that we use in everyday language, which seems stronger, may not actually have much meaning in legal terms. So that's something I will investigate, and if necessary, we'll bring an amendment if the advice is that this indeed would make the bill stronger. But that said, I am relaxed about the wording, and the echo the comments Alex Atwood made, the constructive nature by which the Office of First and Deputy First Minister engaged with the bill, it makes me think that the language that has come from the department is there to assist rather than somehow to escape responsibility. Similar to that point, and indeed I think it was in reference to this point that Alex Atwood talked about the genuine spirit of the work of the department, The question had been raised about the term as far as consistent with proper exercise of their functions in relation to the statutory duty to cooperate. And again, this was a phrase that I interrogated. I think I made reference in the open market, it was Daniel Greenberg who described that as a avoidance heffalump. And I think what it came down to when I interrogated this was different styles of drafting, different opinions. I did seek a number of opinions. It's not unusual language, and what I didn't find was examples where departments had used this type of language to avoid their responsibilities. So in the absence of evidence of harm of this sort of language, I was relaxed about its usage and am content with that regard. And I think Mr. Atwood was when I intervened and explained my position. Both Megan Fearn and Chris Little highlighted that Amendment 2 is key to the bill, and it absolutely underpins the purpose of the bill. It's about cooperation. That's what the purpose of the bill was when I set out on this journey, and absolutely Amendment 2, and being the latest draft, the latest iteration of that purpose, I think it's essential that the Assembly supports that today in terms of the bill going forward. Amendment 3, Megan Fearn highlighted the need not just to consult with children, but to ensure that different socio-economic backgrounds were captured in any consultation. And I think that is right. Whilst this is a bill about children and, I suppose, about age, I think it is important that we do look at socio-economic background, that we don't just consult those who may seem easiest to reach or most able, but actually seek to engage those who might otherwise seen as being marginalised in society, and I think it was a point well made. Amendment 4, Alex Atwood described this, the pooling of resources, as taking the bill from one of process to one of product, and I like that phrasing, because to me it is essential. It is an essential part of the journey, and the research that I did around this, and there was a great piece of guidance from the Department of Communities in the UK on the pooling of resources. It showed that aligned budgets was what took place before the culture of true cooperation really happened. So first the departments, agencies, whatever it might be, would hold their own budgets but work together. But the natural course of trust and cooperation, the pooled budgets would be the outcome and indeed the most effective measure. And if we look at some of the evidence of where the Children's Act in England didn't contain the statutory duty on which a large part of this bill was inspired by, the evidence is in England where cooperative work and where integrated services take place, there are more efficient use of resources, meaning more money gets to those who need it, meaning better outcomes in the long term. In Amendment 5, there was welcome throughout the House for delay and the desire to get this right. I hope with the contributions made around Amendment 5 that there is a willingness to continue the work on this clause. As I say, the time frame will be weeks rather than months because this bill does need to progress. But I think if there's a will, there is a way. I think we're close to the end product, and I hope by further consideration stage we can achieve that end product and get an amendment that receives unanimous support. Amendment 6, the chair of the committee suggested that the report didn't include a report on outcomes, just cooperation. And I would draw the member's attention. I appreciate he may be drawn elsewhere in terms of the closing stages of this debate, but for the record, in Amendment 6, 4B, subsection 3B, does say that the report must include statements on what progress has been made towards achieving those outcomes or the extent to which they have been achieved. So I think I think while the Chair was right to draw attention to the importance of measuring outcomes and reporting on outcomes, I do believe it's sufficiently contained in the bill. But if that in any way can be strengthened, I'm certainly open to looking at that. A number of members and throughout the process, the question of how regular reporting should take place, whether it should be annual, whether it should be every 3 years, every 2 years, or what it might be. And I know in discussions with some of the stakeholders, there was a contentment that within the children's plan, there be an annual review of the children's plan, that alongside the three-year reporting on the overall statutory duty to cooperate in the children's strategy, that this may be sufficient. But I make note of Mr. Atwood's point that perhaps if this legislation is passed and there's a feeling that nothing needs to take place for no reporting for 3 years, that there may be less urgency than otherwise might be the case. I think that would be something I'd be willing to look at, even if it's perhaps an initial report after 1 or 2 years, with maybe reporting every 3 years, because certainly what I don't want to be, and a lot of the concern was about when I at second stage and indeed in presenting to the committee, was the possibility that this becomes overly bureaucratic and that departments spend more time reporting on how they're cooperating than actually cooperating. So I have sought to find a balance, but perhaps that initial impetus, perhaps there is something that could be looked at there to ensure that the urgency of the bill is not lost in a reporting time frame that maybe allows too much time to come to terms with it. Again, the Chair raised the issue, the Chair of the Committee raised the issue that had been raised by stakeholders as to whether or not there should be an independent report on the effectiveness of the bill. And this is something I looked at and expressed my view to the committee that I would look at it. And I didn't find a great desire to have in the bill the requirement for an independent report, but it was pointed out to me that it was well within the Children's Commissioner's powers and remit to produce such a report. So that ability was already there, and indeed in speaking to the Children's Commissioner, and I have to say both the present Children's Commissioner and the previous one have been very supportive of the bill, and indeed the Commission has produced a number of pieces of research that points to the need for a statutory duty to cooperate. But I got the impression in my engagement with the Commissioner that the Commission would very much be keen and to produce a report on the bill alongside that of the Department rather than instead of. There was a feeling actually that if the requirement to report was taken away from the Department, that it might actually have the unintended consequence of taking away the desire to put into place the requirements of the bill. So those, I believe, were the main comments around specific clauses. However, there were a number of points that I will touch on briefly that I thought added positively to the debate. I think Alex Atwood's highlight of the child poverty rates in Northern Ireland, whilst it's not a bill specifically on child poverty, it's very much a bill that would have the ambition of helping in strategies to combat child poverty and indeed ensuring that the child poverty strategy is joined up and government departments work in a joined up fashion in tackling this issue. I think it was worth highlighting because, again, this is a bill very much about process in terms of its drafting, but in terms of its ambition, it is about changing children's lives for the better, about reducing wasted opportunities and wasted potential that might arise from the lack of supports available for some of the children in need in our society. So I thought highlighting actually the failures of governance in terms of child poverty was beneficial. And indeed, he made reference to Mr. Atwood made reference to the Scottish model and their more integrated approach. And indeed, I did take time to meet with the Scottish Minister, Aileen Campbell, and to hear about the work of the Children and Young People's Act in Scotland. And indeed, it is very much following this approach of a statutory duty to cooperate. And I think in that regard, that Northern Ireland, in introducing this bill, would simply be following a similar track as to what happened in 2004 in England and more recently in Scotland. The Deputy Chair of the Committee, although I think he was speaking as an Alliance member, Chris Little, did lament the lack of ministerial response. And I am saddened by that, and I won't get too much into the wider politics. My focus is on getting this bill passed. But I think because there has been so much constructive working by OFM, DFM, and indeed the other departments in engaging with this bill, it would have been good to be, as a private member, as a backbencher, standing alongside the junior ministers in bringing forward this bill and bringing forward these amendments, because they have worked constructively and their office has worked constructively. But as I say, I felt it was more important to progress this bill than to worry too much about the choreography. I hope in my contributions that I've given credit where it's due to all stakeholders, and you know, whilst entitled this was a private member's bill by Stephen Agnew. This is very much a collaborative bill of stakeholders, including OFM, DFM, including the other departments, including the committee, including the children's sector. Chris Little made reference to the work of the All Party Group for Children and Young People, secretariat of which is provided by children in Northern Ireland. And the genesis of this bill emerged from that All Party Group. Indeed, I would pay Chris Little tribute to his chairing of the group, and indeed to another contributor, Roy Beggs, who chaired the group during the time when I was researcher to Bran Wilson and sat on the group representing Bran, and that's where the genesis of this bill came from, and where these ideas, I suppose, were kicked around. And indeed, the group under Mr. Begg's chairmanship took this issue to the junior ministers then, and it has been raised on a consistent basis by the group, and I'm delighted now that it's come forward to the chamber that is receiving the support that I believe it deserves. And indeed, I would further like to congratulate Chris Little on his work on children's budgeting. And indeed, he made reference to, I think it was UN comments, the failure to achieve positive outcomes for children are one of our greatest mistakes. And I think that's right. Again, I've talked about wasted opportunity, wasted potential. And that is the result when government structures fail children. The reverse of that is getting it right and making a real difference to the lives of children to help maximise their potential, realise their opportunities, and indeed help tackle disadvantage through poverty and other societal issues. Chris Hazard made reference to the extent of silo mentality within government, and he referenced or he alluded certainly to the report Barriers to Effective Governance by the Children's Commission, which one of its conclusions was that we needed a statutory duty to cooperate. So in bringing forward this bill, I not only came forward but with an idea that had the backing of the sector, that emerged from the sector, but indeed on which the sector had produced significant research. Barriers to Effective Governance was just one piece of research conducted by Queen's Commission, by the Children's Commission, which pointed to that. I'd like to welcome the comments from Sandra Overend in her position as UP spokesperson for children, and indeed welcome her work. And I think reference is made to the work of the Assembly, not just the executive, but the work that private members are doing and the work that Ms. Overend is doing on child protection and internet safety. I think when we take this bill with her work, with the work around children's budgeting that Chris Little's engaged in, we can see an Assembly that's interested in children's issues and that seeks to make progress on improving outcomes. And I think that constructive relationship between the Assembly and the Executive can only be a good thing. Finally, I think... A couple of further points. Roy Beggs made reference to the work of Professor Heckman, and again, this is underpinning what this bill is about. If we get the processes right, if we get the vehicles for delivery right, we can intervene more effectively and we can intervene earlier. We have the research, we have the evidence. Invest early, and you get better outcomes. Whether it be health, whether it be justice, whether it be education, whether it be employment. It is for the betterment of the Assembly betterment of society to invest in the early years of a child's development. Put in the supports then, and we can avoid many of the problems that dog our society, whether it be poverty, crime, or educational underachievement. Another, I suppose, criticism of the bill that came from both the chair of the committee and from Mr. McAllister was the lack of sanctions. And this was something that I looked at, and I looked across legislation. And whilst I can understand the compulsion to have some sort of punitive sanction in there. I was at a loss to find any good examples. How do we put in legislation a punishment on the executive or even individual departments? Do we fine them? And if it's a fine on the executive doesn't promote cooperation. Who fines the executive? What are we fining? And how does it help? Why would we fine departments? Where does the money go to? What's the incentive? And actually, looking through legislation, it is judicial review is the normal mechanism of sanction. It is legal action, and whilst it might not be ideal, short of any alternative proposals coming forward, I was at a loss into how I could put sanctions into this bill that would be constructive and beneficial in terms of achieving the proposals contained within the bill. So I'm sympathetic to those who want, like me, to see this bill to be as strong as it can possibly be. But I think the accountability of reporting, the accountability to this Assembly, the accountability to committees, the accountability to the public, and indeed I made reference to the powers of the Children's Commission, those in the first instance are what the departments will pay regard to. But the threat of judicial review is not a minor threat, and I think it is one that departments are mindful of. And I do think it is, in that regard, a useful tool for holding departments to account. So to conclude, Principal Deputy Speaker, I would like to thank all members for their contribution. I'd like to thank, and be specific in this, the work of children in Northern Ireland and their membership, the Children's Commissioner and her team, and indeed the Children's Law Centre, all of who have been working for, calling for, and have driven the calls for this piece of legislation or something similar to it. I hope today, and I know that there will be many watching, that they feel that the Assembly has listened, that we have stepped up, and we will take action to end the waste that's created from duplication, end the wasted opportunities and potential that poverty and the other consequences of lack of support for children and families creates. And I hope in this bill we can achieve better outcomes for children in Northern Ireland. Thank you.
Before I put the question, I remind members that we have debated Mr. Agnew's opposition to Clause 1, but the question will be put in the positive as usual. Members will also note that Clause 1 is mutually exclusive with Amendment 1. The question is that Clause 1 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The noes have it. The noes have it. Amendment 1 has already been debated. I call Mr. Agnew to move formally Amendment 1.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 1, insert new Clause 1A, well-being of children and young people, young persons, as printed on the Marshall list. The question is that Amendment 1 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 2 has already been debated. I call Mr. Agnew to move formally Amendment 2.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 1, insert new Clause 1B, cooperation to improve well-being as printed on the Marshall list. The question is that Amendment 2 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 3 has already been debated. I call Mr. Agnew to move formally Amendment 3.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 1, insert new Clause 1C, Children and Young Persons Strategy, as printed on the Marshall list. The question is that Amendment 3 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to Clause 2. Members will note that Clause 2 is mutually exclusive with Amendment 6. Before I put the question, I remind members that we have debated Mr. Agnew's opposition to Clause 2, but the question will be put in the positive as usual. The question is that Clause 2 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The noes have it. The noes have it. No amendments have been tabled to Clause 3. Members will note that Clause 3 is mutually exclusive with Amendment 4. Mr. Agnew's opposition to Clause 3 has already been debated. The question is that Clause 3 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The noes have it. The noes have it. Amendment 4 has already been debated. I call Mr. Agnew to formally move Amendment 4.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 3, insert new Clause 3A, sharing of resources and pooling of funds, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 4 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Clause 4. No amendments have been tabled to Clause 4, and members will note that Clause 4 is mutually exclusive with Amendment 5. Before I put the question, I remind members that we have debated Mr. Agnew's opposition to Clause 4, but the question will be put in the positive as usual. The question is that Clause 4 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The noes have it. The noes have it. Amendment 5 has already been debated. I call Mr. Agnew to formally move Amendment 5.
Not moved.
Amendment 5, not moved. Amendment 6 has already been debated. Amendment 6 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendments 3 to 5. I call Mr. Agnew to move formally Amendment 6.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 4, insert new Clause 4B, report on the operation of this Act, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 6 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 7 has already been debated. I call Mr. Agnew to move formally Amendment 7.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 4, insert new Clause 4C, guidance, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 7 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to Clause 5. Before I put the question, I remind members that we have debated Mr. Agnew's opposition to Clause 5. The question is that Clause 5 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The noes have it. The noes have it. Amendment 5 has already been debated. Amendment 8 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendments 1 to 7. I call Mr. Agnew to move formally Amendment 8. Amendment proposed after Clause 5, insert new Clause 5A, interpretation as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 8 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 9 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendment 3. I call Mr. Agnew to move formally Amendment 9.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 5, insert new Clause 5B, commencement, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 9 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to Clause 6. The question is that Clause 6 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 10 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendments 1 and 3. I call Mr. Agnew to move formally Amendment 10.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to the long title, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 10 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that the long title as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. This concludes the consideration stage of the Children's Services Cooperation Bill. The bill stands referred to the Speaker.